train crashes are thankfully rare. In fact, the rail network is by far the most heavily controlled environment in the country. It's why nuclear waste is transported by rail rather than road, because we don't have barely trained and patient speed freaks treating the rails like their own personal fiefdom. Anyway, when train crashes do happen, they can be horrifically brutal, and a good number have happened throughout the years. So come with me as we talk about the various train crashes in and around the Lothians. So there seems to be this weird belief amongst a selection of the general public that trains are like cars and can stop on a dime. This can best be seen in all the videos of people fucking around on level crossings, but the truth is they cannot stop on a dime. You see, one of the things that makes trains so efficient as a form of transport is also one of the things that makes them have a long stopping distance. They are large collections of fast-moving items on metal rails moving at high speeds. That is why we have signals and signals for those signals. You see, railways, especially higher speed ones, have four aspect signals with four lights. Green, double yellow, single yellow, and stop. Green is obvious. It means all clear. Double yellow means you should slow down now because the next signal is going to be single yellow. Single yellow is get ready to stop, the next light is red. And finally, red means stop. Do not go further. Stop right now, immediately, and drast the hen. The fact that there are two yellow signals just goes to show how long it takes for a train to stop. Now, there are many reasons why train crashes happen, but they can be largely grouped into the following categories. Human-caused, train malfunction, and infrastructure malfunction. But all of these things can merge together into one big lump, and sometimes there are exceptions to the rule. Like, take the Pullman disaster, which was caused by an animal on the line. A cow is neither human, part of the infrastructure, nor part of the train. But to go through some of the most infamous train accidents to prove my point, the Tay Bridge disaster was an infrastructure malfunction, Quinton's Hill was human-caused, and Eschedder was a train malfunction. So why don't we get into some train crashes in Lothian, shall we? The Edinburgh to Glasgow Railway is by far the busiest in Scotland. It was the first intercity railway in Scotland, and being between Scotland's biggest city and its capital, it's no wonder it's so busy. So let's talk about the Winchborough crash. Winchborough is 4 kilometres west of Kirkliston, but the crash itself happened near Old Philipston. The crash happened on the 13th of October 1862, and the layout of the track and the trackside played a role. The area of the crash happened in a deep cutting on a curve that still exists to this day, which limits visibility. Another thing that played a role in the accident was the fact that due to track works, there was only one line in use. So, to protect trains and to prevent crashes on the day, a pilot engine was being used to escort trains for the single track section. The pilot engine was a small and distinctive looking locomotive, but said locomotive was being used for other duties on the site and a larger one was being used in its stead. The pointsman, who was working as a signalman on the site, saw the Glasgow bound train with a ballast train behind it and thought that that was the pilot train. He let it through without knowing that the Edinburgh bound train was still on the line. On seeing each other on the same track, both drivers slammed on the brakes to slow each train, but both trains hit at a relative speed of 30 miles per hour. The Glasgow driver leapt from the cab and survived with injuries, but both firemen and the driver on the other train died along with 15 passengers. An uninjured passenger made their way to Craigdon House near the line, commandeered a horse and cart, and went to Linlithgow to raise the alarm and to get doctors on the scene of the crash. Today, when work is done on the line, there are much more rigorous safety procedures to stop an incident like Winchborough happening again. So, when you hear that there's maintenance work on the line, meaning that your journey will be delayed, don't get so annoyed because the alternative is, well, a massive crash. Ah, North Berwick. The Berwick of the North. Now, there have been two train crashes in North Berwick, one in the 1970s, I believe, but I couldn't find any information on that one, but I did find some information on the one that happened in 1884. Now, here's the thing about North Berwick in 1884. Its station was a lot more substantial than today, with two platforms, actual platform buildings, and a goods yard. It also had longer platforms than today, with the station coming up to the road itself. So that is the where, what about the what? Well, let's lay down the accident. It was the 14th of August 1884 at 11:45 p.m. and a train from Edinburgh overran the ticket platform, entered a set of sidings and came into collision with a set of carriages. But this wasn't the most insane part of the whole thing. Let me just quote from the report directly. None of the passengers in the carriages were injured, but a passenger who, with another, was riding on the engine had his arm cut off, and the driver and fireman were injured, the former so severely that I have not been able to examine him until yesterday. So today this practice has a name. It's called train surfing, and it's not merely dangerous but also very illegal. So not only did you have someone train surfing, but they had been involved in an accident. The conclusion stated that the Westinghouse brake, aka the air brake, had broken down earlier on that day, but with no time to repair it, the driver just used the handbrake to slow the engine down. Whereas the handbrake only works with the train and the guard's fan, air brakes operate throughout a train, operating the brakes on the carriages rather than just the locomotive. Not to sound like Captain Obvious here, but spreading all the braking force over a train and not just having it all on the locomotive means that the train can come to a much quicker stop. This wouldn't be the last time that failed air brakes would cause a train crash, and dare I say, a much more deadly one. The 1988 Gare de Lyon rail accident happened when, after an incident where a passenger pulled the emergency brake to get off at a station that the train was not timetabled to stop at, the driver and the guard accidentally broke the air brakes on the train, causing it to crash into another train, killing 56. In short, air brakes are very important, and without them, we would likely not have the rail transport we have today, and if they fail, well, you wouldn't want to be on that train, so let's give up for air brakes, shall we? The Longniddry Junction train crash happened on the 17th of December 1953. Just for context, Longniddry was then a three-platform station, with the third platform being for the line to Haddington. The actual crash happened about 18 yards east of the station. It started with a freight train carrying some temporary track in an open wagon just before the accident, which had fallen off the train. The train involved in the accident was a special parcels train going from Edinburgh to King's Cross, hauled by a BR Standard Class 7 locomotive, meaning the locomotive in question was actually relatively new. At about 1:18 a.m, the train hit the piece of track at about 60 miles per hour and was derailed. The driver was severely injured while the fireman died at the scene. The blame was placed on the security of the ropes on the train carrying the temporary track on the train before, stating that it might be better to use two ropes to attach open wagon cargo in the future. This will not be the last time something on the tracks would cause an accident. We all remember the Stonehaven crash, which was caused by a landslide. But then again, there was also the Pullman rail crash, which happened when a train hit a cow, or the Greenock rail crash, which happened when vandals placed concrete cable covers on the track. I mean, generally placing anything on tracks is a bad idea, so please do not put shit onto the tracks. Okay, so I have spoken about this crash in another video when I did Disappearing Stations videos. Remember those? I remember those. Back in the days when I left the house on a regular basis. Now I just sit.
My desolate room. No lights. No music. Just ever. Killed everyone.
Come away forever.
But I'm feeling better.
Okay, sorry for the System of a Down reference, everyone. Anyway, back to the matter at hand. This happened at Raffles Station, which is at, guess where? Raffles Station. It happened on the 3rd of January 1917, and to explain what happened, I need to talk about the station layout at the time. RAFO was a free platform station with an up and down platform for the Edinburgh Glasgow lines and a single platform below it for the now closed and built over Kirkliston Queensferry lines. All of this will contribute to the accident. Alongside this, there was stormy weather, adding weather to the mix. But anyway, the crash involved two trains, an MBRH class called Dunedin and another local that I couldn't find any information on. The Dalmeny local arrived at RAFO and the signal intended to hold the train there but intended to use hand signals because there was no holding signal. The local was decoupled, presumably because it already had carried out its service, to head back to the depot as a light engine, or in normie speak, as a single locomotive pulling nothing else. The signalman tried to stop the train but couldn't reach the driver due to the storm happening at the time. Coming in the other direction was the aforementioned H-class loco pulling an Edinburgh to Glasgow express full of people coming home from Hogmanay. The trains collided at 30 miles per hour, killing 12 and injuring 46. The Board of Trade placed blame on the signalman for using hand signals on an access to a pasture line rather than a regular signal. I can't figure out why hand signals were being used rather than regular signals. Perhaps because it was unusual working or because the signals themselves weren't working. Maybe the storm made it harder to see the signals. There were signals at the junction just after the signal box. Maybe the signalman thought that because it was a shunting job, fiddling around with the signals just wasn't worth it. Either way, the whole debacle resulted in the deaths of 12 people on one of Scotland's busiest routes. Today, thanks to all the safety features and the lessons learnt, train crashes are thankfully rare and rail travel is one of the safest forms of transport out there. The rails are the most heavily controlled environments in the country and for good reason, so next time you head on the train, you can sit back safe in the knowledge that you are going to get to your destination safely. Unless, of course, you see someone riding on the side of the train.